For no institution can that little aphorism be truer than for the Whitney Museum, seen here at 99 Hanford Street, its new home for about a month, and in its first site on West 8th Street, which will concern us today. As we say, the Whitney is fitting that it's moved back to its downtown roots. That's vaguely so we can decide what is different and what is the same. But its original home, of course, was in the village. And also, in Whitney's case, we have to amend that saying, of course, because here we have the shadows of two extraordinary women. Gertrude Vanderbilt Whitney, founder of the museum, who supplied the money and the original idea, and Juliana Force, the first director of the museum, the dynamo who powered the institution from day to day, and the one who took Gertrude's vision and made it something concrete. A succession of workable enterprises that were unflagging in their championship of American art. Before the partnership of Gertrude Whitney and Juliana Force, American art was scorned as vulgar and insignificant by all but the tiniest minority. Before the Whitney, museums tended to seem like the natural enemies of living artists. Museums tend to be collectors, but not patrons involved in artists caring about their welfare and the progress of their work. These women and their museum were first and foremost patrons. Some of you may be familiar with the outlines of Gertrude Whitney's life. So I'm going to concentrate at first on Juliana Force, who has remained a fairly unknown figure, and I might add unfairly, given how much she did for American artists. By the end of my talk, I hope you'll realize that the social history of American art, that is how American art has been perceived and received, was significantly shaped by this strong, vibrant, forceful woman. And believe me, she was aptly named. It's impossible to talk or write about Juliana Force without putting on the name Force, along with an almost lunatic sense of generosity, was her outstanding characteristic. Juliana Force's story has always interested me, not just as an art story, but as a classic American success story. She made a place for herself, and the world gave way to it. She made herself up, and she got away with that, too. The phrase that I think describes her best comes from Coriolanus. She was author of herself and knew no other kid. Well, of course, she did have kid in origins, just like everyone else. The problem was they were just too much like everyone else's for Juliana's taste. She was born in Juliana Rieser in Doylestown, Pennsylvania, in Bucks County near Philadelphia in 1876, one of 14 children. Her father was a hatter and then a grocer, and given the large number of children in the Rieser family, they were poor. Juliana Rieser didn't like being poor, and even as a little girl, she felt self-conscious about it, and as soon as she could do something about it, she would. She also didn't like living in Hoboken, New Jersey, where the Riesers moved to in 1885, 100 years before they became trendy. As time went on, she would hide that, as well as the family's economic status, saying that she had spent her youth on the family estate in Bucks County. So, as you see, Juliana Rieser was highly imaginative, and she was considered a brilliant student by her teachers and other adults. She wanted to be a writer and hoped to go to Wells, but that proved to be impossible financially. But she did get enough education to enable her to teach one of the few positions open to a woman of her class at the time. In the early 1900s, she taught English and stenography classes at a business school in Hoboken. During this time, she met Hilary Force, a dentist whom she would marry in 1912. Unfortunately for Juliana, Dr. Force was married to someone else when they met, and their relationship was scandalous in a small town. It rocked the Rieser family, but as one of Juliana's nieces said, whatever most girls did had nothing to do with Aunt Jewel. She was a law unto herself. Nevertheless, having an affair with a married man was not something young lady school teachers did, and Juliana felt it better to quit her job in Hoboken in about 1906 or 1907 and go to work in the vast, anonymous, swirling world of New York. And in Juliana set herself up as a freelance stenographer in Manhattan, renting an office at 34th and Madison, just across the street from, if you recall, the Alden's department store. Very quickly on, she began substituting for the social secretaries of wealthy society women when those secretaries were sick or on vacation. She was a great success at this, and before long, she knew the social register upside down and backwards and became very familiar with the etiquette and preferences of the family community. Presumably, this is how she came to work for Helen Hay Whitney, Gertrude Whitney's sister-in-law, in about 1907. The most fascinating and curious aspect of Juliana's work for Helen Whitney is the change in her handwriting. Regrettably, I don't have any images to show you, but Juliana's writing before Helen Whitney was a very correct Palmer script. Afterwards, it changed permanently into a passable imitation of Helen Whitney's hand. The two were practically indistinguishable. It's the first tangible surviving evidence of Juliana's aptitude for picking up the mannerisms and flourishes of a class well beyond her. Later on, as much as the embroidered pedigree, she would develop a cultivated neo-British accent. By 1907, Gertrude Whitney had come a long way, although from where she grew up, but from the opposite end of the social spectrum. Born in 1875, Gertrude was a Vanderbilt heir to Whitney, which is all that anyone should have wanted. With a fortune of at least $100 million at her fingertips, she could and did have houses, clothes, jewels, and travel in grand style, which she did. This is, by the way, it was an entire city block, and when it was knocked down, this is where Bergdorf Goodman is right now, but it's bigger than Bergdorf, because it went all the way down to 6th Avenue. But after producing three children and becoming disillusioned with her husband, Harry Whitney, who was chronically promiscuous, she was determined to reshape her life and find a more fulfilling identity. That identity was as an artist and art patron. In early 1907, she leased a stable at 19 McDougal Alley in Greenwich Village, which is a million miles away, thought and attitude from that enormous house on Fifth Avenue where she and her husband lived, and which was not particularly different from the house where she grew up. As you see, McDougal Alley, just before the moved, and the very recent pictures, except for the two Fifth Avenue. Now, I just love this because this is so New York City. Okay, 1906, 2000, ruts in the road, but still not been fixed. Now, Gertrude, which this is her first stable, it's all the way back here, but just studios that. Gertrude would make this stable into a studio for working and getting away from her uptown life. In March of 1907, Gertrude was organizing an exhibition for the Colony. Exclusive women's club, but the details of renovating McDougal Alley and the other things that she had to do were a little bit overwhelming, so she needed help. Helen Whitney, who was an officer of the Colony Club, knew just the person to assist her, enter Juliana Force. Juliana Force made a hit with Gertrude because she had the wit to perceive that success lay in being vivid rather than sedate. Vividness and attractive Gertrude was always on the lookout for quote unquote big personalities. Juliana worked for Gertrude off and on over the next few years as her secretary, studio manager, and confidant, and they emerged as a permanent team. They were not only employer and employee, but confederates in bohemia, learning as they went and living much later in life. Now, what was the basis of their association? Well, Juliana was fun. She was also intelligent, only amusing, and she took Gertrude seriously, but she wasn't an artist, so she wasn't a competition. I also think that because they both have been different and faced the obstacles that came from being different, that these two women could understand each other across the gulf that otherwise separated them in wealth, position, and upbringing. In other words, both of them were women who had broken the mold before the mold broke them. This can be seen in the bold move that Gertrude made in February of 1908 when she went to the Macbeth Gallery on Fifth Avenue for preview of what we now recognize as an historic Hart Benton, the first and only exhibition of the age. Robert Henri, John Sloan, William Blackness, Everett Shinn, George Lucas, Ernest Lawson, Harvey Davies, and Maurice Prendergast. Out of the 7 pictures sold from the show, Gertrude lost 4, which you were seeing the first 2, all of which are in the Whitney's collection to this day. Here's the 2nd one. When you go to the Whitney, the first gallery on the lobby floor that is devoted to the 8th Street Museum, you'll see the shame painting and that is up. Now, it's hard to see with these paintings what all the fuss was about, but they did extend the subject matter for art, which remains a controversial thing to do to this day. As John Sloan said, at that time, to buy such unfashionable pictures was almost as revolutionary as painting them. As such, these purchases represent a new step in the context of Gertrude's own growth and self-realization. The War of the 8 were waging against the closed exhibitions of the National Academy of Design, the headline whose arch enemy was equivalent to Gertrude's own determination to break out of a repressive environment and find a meaningful identity. This is Gertrude Whitney as Henry painted her in a pose and costume that was a manifesto of a new woman with a bohemian vision. And again, she's sort of come a long way from those early pictures I showed you. The next activity that concerns us came in late 1914. In 1913, Gertrude had a lease 8 West 8th Street, the townhouse attached to 19 Medieval Avenue, to use what today we call an alternative space. But nothing much had happened because Gertrude Whitney went off to Paris, which she loved for long stretches of time. She was able to get away from her husband and live a free life. But in August 1914 came World War I, and Gertrude, who was an ardent Francophile, immediately pledged to build a field hospital in France. She also wanted to raise money in New York, but how to do it? The answer was simple, even obvious, but eventually monumental. Sponsor an art exhibition for the benefit of French war relief in her own galleries on 8th Street, and let Juliana run it. Thus, it was World War I that launched Mrs. H.P. Whitney's studio, as the galleries were first called, as a going concern and crystallized Juliana Force's position as an art impresario. She organized not one, but 2 benefit shows, both of which took place in December of 1914. Some of the artists who participated in these inaugural shows on West 8th Street were headline, Daniel Chester French, Walt Kuhn, Blackens, Alvina Hoffman, Lawson, Davies, Paul Manship, George Bellows, and E. Clark. So the Whitney Studio pretty much started as it meant to go on. The shows had a didactic or charitable intent. They were well-intentioned, but artistically negligible. However, things began looking up in early 1916 when John Sloan was introduced into the Whitney Inner Circle. Now, Sloan had a name as an artist, but he was 44 years old and he had only sold 1 painting to date to the magnificently irascible Philadelphia director, Albert Barnes. Sloan had no dealer and he had never had a one-person show. He wrote to Gertrude in January of 1916 asking her to give him one. Gertrude was planning to show her own sculpture at the studio at the end of January, but she magnanimously gave up the slot and put Sloan in and he had his first ever. The exhibition was enormously better than the average Whitney Studio fair, and everybody said as much. As for Sloan, even though he didn't sell any work, the show impressed John Krauschauer, who offered to represent him, and the connection with the Krauschauer galleries continues to this day. Shortly after the show, Sloan began painting this portrait of Juliana. And later on, as I said, the Sloan exhibition was the memorable exception in the Whitney studio days because there was no direction. The studio was generous, but it was aimless. In January 1917, while the show called, "Whom Should I Go for My Portraits On?", Juliana spotted a man hovering around the table of photographs reserved for the press. She approached him and asked him his name. It was the art critic Forrest Watson. For years, Watson had been lambasting. Studio was well-meaning but inept, so he had been in no hurry to make himself known to Juliana. When Juliana asked him how he liked the show, Watson did not flinch. He told her it was terrible. Not only was this particular show egregious, but the studio itself had taken no defining stand. double presence of society, acts would come for nothing in the serious art world. The studio and the sideshow never a main event. Surely this was not what Whitney had intended. Well, Juliana was stunned, but she knew Watson was right, and he, along with Avis Sloan Dubois, would start advising her. When the new season started in late 1917, the drawing room portraits were out, and the vigorous artists were in. And that season, Maurice Prendergast, Charles Drew, Glenn Coleman, and Stuart Davis were invited to exhibit the film for the first time. From then on, there would be no more prizes and competitions. Instead, Gertrude or Juliana would buy a work on nearly every show. They decided that the only way to really reward artists was to buy their work. You also have to understand that the purchases were not so much to build up a collection, although naturally that would be the end result, but to share relief in the artists. A purchase was a testament of faith in the artist's future and the future of American art, which was supposedly laughed at or ignored. This strong belief, this unflagging sympathy for artists, this determination to ease their personal and professional problems, especially financial need, were rare at the time. Not only did most museums not show the work of contemporary artists, but they regarded them as minor nuisances to be brushed away like gnats. Now, the governing taste of the Whitney art collection, as it was being formed, was American realism, which was a direct outgrowth of the connection with the handwriting. And the general way the Whitney would be conducted also derived from the beliefs, the democratic beliefs of Henry Sloan. A guiding principle was one of inclusivity. Since non-academic artists like Henry Sloan had histories of being denied access to large audiences, they could not overstate the value of extending broad sympathies to all varieties of aesthetic impulses. Juliana Whitney would show a wide variety of art, and they about it. Whitney was capable of being avant-garde at one exhibition, traditional at the next, and unclassifiable the time after that. There was no special drive to be consistently modern mistress, as being vanguard. The aim was to be progressive and, moreover, pro-artist, regardless of style or school. Juliana Force could say, "We have always maintained the open door of larger exhibits and more artists exhibiting." Operative phrase here is the open door. Now, while she was reshaping the Whitney studio, Juliana was also remaking her own life along lines that were more congenial to her own view of herself. In 1914, she and her husband bought Marley Sheep Farm, a 60-acre farm near Doylestown, which became the instant ancestral heap in the family for generations. At the farm, Juliana began to indulge her love of decorating and creating environments that most people thought were outlandish. She was the first to collect Shaver and Victoriana, and at that time, the adjective Victoria, when applied to art or furniture, was one of a withering reproach. And she also, and this was another pioneering enthusiasm, began a lifelong love affair with American folk art. She was one of the earliest collectors in that field, too. Here are a couple of examples of the many paintings that she owned. Juliana used to drive around rural Pennsylvania in search of folk art antiques, and her driving was so characteristic that it defines her. Dr. Force always had a big, shiny black packer, which she was not allowed to touch. It was probably the only thing he ever forbade her. Juliana piloted, or rather aimed, an old station wagon at the road. She never learned to reverse. She could only go forward, and the world had to make way for her. One of her nephews summarized motoring Juliana's style as follows. Well, Aunt Jewel drove fearlessly and dreadfully. Once she overturned her station wagon in a ditch. Another time she started on a trip to Philadelphia, changed her mind, asked the passing stranger to turn the car around and get it back, just as well for Philadelphia. In February of 1918, Gertrude Juliana decided that though the artists needed a place to mix and mingle when they weren't working, and out of their talks came a decision to do something about care, feeding, and entertainment of young artists, who they saw as an endangered species. This new activity, which would also have exhibitions, was called the Whitney Studio Club, and any artist who showed promise would join. It was first housed at 147 West 4th Street, besides shows, there were parties with lots of free food for hungry members, and the Up Club also held a live class. It cost 20 cents to attend, which was a real boon for most of the theaters who couldn't afford to hire a professional model. The club was a big success, it started, and about 50 to 60 members signed up during that first year in 1918. And Juliana started to do some talent spotting. I say Juliana because Gertrude began to move off from the epicenter of activity. World War I was over, and Gertrude started spending at least 6 months of every year in Europe. She also became very involved with commissions for war memorials. There wasn't as much time for the Whitney Studio or the Whitney Studio Club, and indeed, this is why she employed Juliana Force to spend her money constructively and mediate between herself and the artist she was doing so much to help. Furthermore, Gertrude wasn't so very much at home with the next wave of struggling artists. The disparity between her studio's assistance and expensive materials and their lack of basic necessities made her feel a little ill at ease. Gertrude put in appearances in the club, and she was always gracious, but she was more remote from the day-to-day goings on. So if Gertrude was the artist's fairy godmother, then Juliana was the dea ex machina, arriving providentially to intervene when the situation grew desperate. She used to carry around a little black book when she heard about an artist in distress or whose work deserves some attention. She jotted down the name and followed up on it later. As I'm sure everyone in this room realizes, when we work with contemporary art, and in the Whitney's case, art with paint, hair, design, you're bound to make mistakes. And for every needy and worthwhile artist Juliana found her help, there were seven or eight who deserved to be forgotten. Juliana didn't pretend to clairvoyance about regrettably either, but said as much. She was prepared to encourage any artist who was serious, any artist who could be at least suspected of talent, of merit. The door had to remain open. In other words, I'm going to be showing you the high spots at acquisitions and exhibitions. In 1918, Juliana Force gave the Dubois first solo show, and then Dubois brought to her attention the work of one of his best friends, a man whom he deserved. He believed deserved an exhibition. The man had no dealer or his living as a commercial illustrator. Dubois' friend, of course, was Edward Hopper. And in January 1920, the Whitney Club gave him the first show he ever had. He exhibited early paintings in Paris, but I think you can see the telltale brushwork and the glimmerings of that radiant Hopper light. In April 1921, Stuart Davis was given a show, and he was asked to exhibit his latest paintings in watercolors. As the Globe was the first to show several important paintings from Davis's incredibly advanced tobacco series. But regrettably, Juliana was out of town during this Davis's show, so nothing was bought from him. Juliana and Gertrude had been helping out with sculptor Gaston Rocher since at least 1918. And in 1922, Juliana met Ruben Nockian, who was sharing a studio with Rocher's. Nockian was poor, blunt, and in his own words, a young savage who wasn't social at all. But Juliana saw that he had talent. She went to his studio with Forbes Watson, who was by now her lover as well as chief advisor, and they watched Nockian part of the stone. A week later, Juliana telephoned Nockian with the news that he would be receiving $250 a month, enabling him to buy stone and move into a studio of his own. The checks started arriving in 1923. They were followed by two one-man shows, and they arrived every month for the next 5 years. And a lap dog is a little gift Nockian made for Juliana after she gave the show in 1926. They both loved Friday night, and this was the now, all these pieces that I'm showing you with the locations because they are in the museum. Now, 50 years after all this all occurred, Nockian was still marveling at the freedom of the arrangement, and he told me there were no strings attached, the checks came in the mail, I never met Mrs. Whitney. Everything was done through Mrs. Force, who left me alone for years. She trusted me and comprehended what I was, a strange artist needed my privacy. Without the Whitney, it would have been tough. I don't know how I would have gotten through. And after Juliana's death, Nockian donated this sculpture to the museum. 23, the club moved from Westport to 10 West 8th Street, next door to the Whitney Studio at 8 West 8th. Even though they were next to each other, both the club and the studio maintained separate exhibition schedules to allow as much work as possible to be seen by the public. Now, a significant limit is the artist Charles Schuler, who photographed those interiors, because in 1923 he started benefiting in a major way from the Whitney largesse. Juliana met Schuler about 1920, and they had a great deal in common. Schuler rented a house in Doylestown, and he too was immersed in folk art and shaker objects. Juliana invited Schuler and his wife to move into a rent-free apartment above the club at 10 West 8th Street. And in March 1924, Schuler had a person show at the Whitney Studio. Juliana bought the drawing Bucks County Barn out of the show for herself, which she later donated to the museum, and it remains a touchstone of the permanent collection to this day. Pertaining to yachts and yachting, another find that made by the artist in the show had already come into Juliana's hands. One day I visited two Schuler's rooms above the club. Juliana saw the drawing and asked him what he was going to do with it. Schuler made a dismissive motion as if he were on the verge of throwing it away. Juliana said something like, "We'll see about that," and nipped out the door with it. So, as you can gather, she usually did as she pleased. In 1928, one of Stuart Davis's classic egg-meter paintings was invited to a group exhibition. No one knew very well about it being abstract, but unfortunately, Davis had neglected to mark which side was the top, and so hung the painting on its side between the two windows. As Davis said, "It just fit it that way. You couldn't turn it right side off and still get it back in the same place." I had what I thought was a pretty novel idea. I went back to the studio and brought in another picture that would fit right side up. But Mrs. Forrest was a strong hero. She liked that egg beater on the side, and that's the way it stayed through the show. However, I hasten to say that Juliana more than redeemed herself with Stuart Davis. In the spring of 1928, she wanted to do something for him. She offered him the rent-free apartment over the club, and she said she would recommend him for a teaching job, but Davis turned her down. Undeterred, she suggested that he go to Europe, because he was one of the few major modernists of his generation who had had no direct experience of French art. Well, Davis liked this idea. Juliana gave him $900, and in May of 1928, he was on his way to Paris. While he was there, she sent him another $500, which enabled him to stay there until August of 1929. The subsidy turned out to be one of Juliana's best investments, because when Davis got back to New York, he gave her three paintings: Egg Beater number 2, Foss Pavlou, and Early American Landscape, all of which Dean Whitney is extremely glad to have, and you will see on the walls today. Now, all of this, the comedy and the errors and the inspirations, such as the first solo shows ever given to Reginald Marsh, John Flanagan, Andrew Jasper, and Isabel Bishop, kept the Whitney Club and studio in their role for years. By 1928, though, the studio was dormant and the club had over 400 members, meaning that it was a perfect grab bag of styles of people. There were two generations of realists, like Sloan and Dubois, Gladys, Hopper, Marsh, Holden, and Bishop. There were the experimenters in modernism, Jasper, Davis, Conrad Palmer, John Matroka, Sheila Demon, John Graham, Niall Spencer, Walt King, Bette Radley Tomlin. There were socially conscious artists like Gordon Robinson and William Crawford, sophisticated faux naives like Yasuo Kuniyoshi, graphic artists like Katie Bacon, Louis Lozowick, and Mark Lewis, and sculptors like Joe Davidson, Lachaise, Flanagan, Nakian, and Omer Moran. But along with being heterogeneous, the club was unwieldy. And it also fulfilled its purpose as a gateway. Younger artists who gave a foothold in the profession, and the dealers were more receptive to emerging talent. The Whitney Studio Club was disbanded, and it was replaced with the Whitney Studio Galleries. The galleries were not really different from the club, except that they had no membership. In other words, the galleries were not a fresh new venture, but an escape from the club. This was unsatisfactory. There was also the matter of the collection. What Gertrude and Juliana had accumulated now amounted to about 500 paintings, sculptures, drawings, and prints, and almost every piece was in dead storage. With art, the art stuck in closets, sometime during the first 2 weeks of October 1929. While she was gone, Gertrude and Watson waited for her to go out of the studio. Robinson was the classical archaeologist who saw nothing of value in her art, so they didn't have long to wait. Juliana was back in no time, smoldering. After some light conversation with Dr. Robinson, Force disclosed Gertrude Whitney's wish to turn over her collection. Before she could say a word about the $5 million endowment, Robinson stopped her from going on. Mrs. Whitney was a charming woman and a great philanthropist, but her request was impossible. And then Robinson said, "What will we do with them all, my dear lady? We have a cellar full of those things already." Well, that was enough for Juliana, who would have her hurricane temper. She stalked out of the metropolitan and went straight back to the little alley, and the whole story came tumbling out. In her fury, she also managed to talk about keeping the collection going despite the lack of space for it. After Gertrude had adjusted to the next rejection, Juliana and Forbes Watson brought up the idea of a museum of her own. In Juliana's words, a new scheme for distilling the American flavor in a specialized museum. And Gertrude was all for it. Watson suggested the title, The Whitney Museum of American Art, and Juliana was made director. That there would be a Whitney Museum was announced in January 1930 that the premises on 8th Street would be expanded. The townhouses at 8, 10, 12, and 14 West 8th Street would be combined. And here is the museum as it looked then, and of course, in the building today, which we all know is the New York Studio School. And because this building is a working art school, I'm sure it's a denouement of which Whitney now in a building that has been used for art for 115 years. Now that the Whitney collection was to be a public one, Force began to buy the work of artists who were not yet represented or insufficiently represented. The idea was to fill gaps, so the comparison would be to a standout, one of this, one of that, which is not the way people tend to buy anymore. But the quality of the selections was so high that I doubt anyone would fault her for how she proceeded. Previously, she largely bought out of Whitney Club shows. Now she went to studios and galleries, so she had a much wider and better range of work to choose from. And she did. The art that Force bought between 1929, when the museum first came into being, and late 1931, when the museum opened, constitutes an astonishing record. It's the best span of buying she ever did. It was astonishing, not only in quality, but in method. She would simply walk into a gallery or studio, take a quick look around, and decide. No trustees, no committees. Juliana started buying from the impending museum in November of 1929 with two paintings by Oscar Blumner. So, you had noticed how she bought an earlier and later example. And she would eventually buy eight photos by Blumner. She also bought Captives in Kansas by John Stuart Curry, the first well-known symbol of the burgeoning movement known as American Scene or Regionalism for $300. I'm not a great fan of regionalism, but this was an important purchase. In May 1930, Juliana bought Thomas Hart Benton's The Lord is My Shepherd, his first fully regional, realized regional painting. And later on in the month, on a visit to the Frank Rand Gallery, she purchased Early Sunday which Hopper had brought to his dealer just 2 months before, and ever since, as we all know, an icon of the collection. At the end of 1930, on another shopping trip, Juliana paid a visit to Reginald Marsh's studio. She took Lloyd Goodrich, whom she had hired in late 1929 as a curator along with her, because Marsh was Goodrich's best friend. They grew up together in Nutley, New Jersey. And Goodrich remembered the incident well and told me, "Marsh had a picture on his easel that he was just finishing. It was Why Not Use the Bell, one of his most ambitious pictures. Mrs. Force looked at it and didn't ask for the price or anything else. She just said, 'I'll take it and send it around to the museum.' After we left, Reg called me up and said, 'What am I supposed to ask him away for the price?' 'Listen, you can't ask me that. I'm with Mrs. Force. Do you suppose $1,500 would be too much? Send in the bill and see what happens.' It was paid without question. She would skip the details Within 2 weeks of seeing and buying Why Not Use the L, Juliana purchased a Chinese restaurant, the finest painting from Max Weber's Cubist space. She was so pleased to deliver it to Mom and her dining room, where it stayed until shortly before it was opened. On January 28, 1931, Crash Out Gallery sent over 7 books by Charles Keith for inspection. And what did Juliana think but mine just one of the best he ever painted? Now, it's extremely telling that Demons came from Krauschauer's gallery and not that of Alfred Stieglitz. You'll remember that when I talked about the Whitney Studio Club being a perfect grab bag of people's styles, there was one group I didn't mention, the artists associated with Alfred Stieglitz. And this was purposeful. In the 1920s, the Stieglitz Circle was not involved in the Whitney Club. They didn't need to be. The club was for artists who did not have dealers, that would be Hardly Marin. Did. More important, there was hostility between Juliana and Forbes Watson on the one hand and Stieglitz on the other. Stieglitz sniped the club for showing too many people instead of a perfect 6 or 7, and Watson sniped Stieglitz for applying the museum code in the cathedral of art. In the 1920s, wooing the Stieglitz artist for the club was more trouble for Juliana than its work, and since the club was a private organization, she could Stieglitz. But once the Whitney became a public institution, the absence of the Stieglitz artist from the collection would have been inexcusable, and Juliana had to make those acquisitions. Stieglitz knew this and would make her pay. Juliana was put in the role of a supplicant, which was not a role she played with grace. She was determined to avoid it until all other strategies had been attempted and exhausted. Primarily, she bought works by Stieglitz artists in the hands of other dealers. In this way, she acquired pictures by Demons, Marin, and Hartman. But when it came to Georgia O'Keeffe, Juliana had to concede the inevitability of Stieglitz, and she went through 2 years of negotiations to get the White Flower and the Mountain in Mexico. The Whitney Museum opened its doors to the public on November 18, 1931, and even its doors were special. They were done by the artist Carl Walters. 4 days before the museum opened, Juliana concluded negotiations for one painting which that she felt she had to have on the walls at the time for the great event. The Whitney did not have a significant figure painting by George Goins, and Juliana wanted nothing from Dempsey Firgo of 1924, which epitomizes the strenuous masculine exertions that Bellows often favored the subject matter for American art. Bellows died in 1925 with a big reputation, and he still had it. His widow, Emma, was well aware of this. Emma Bellows put a budget record price on the picture, $25,000. The final cost was $18,750, but even with the 25% discount, the sum was astronomical for the Depression. To give you some perspective on the prices for American art, what was paid for Dempsey and Firgo was not exceeded by the Whitney until 1960, and then by only a few hundred dollars. Now, of course, if it went today, it would sell for $75 million. Emma Bellows was such a pain for Juliana that everyone suspected that she was the one who led Juliana to say often and loudly, artist widow should commit such a deed. By the time the museum opened, Juliana was quite a personage. As you see, contrasting, retouched, and caricature. Her surface and being had been united since the mid-1920s, and the word everyone applied to her was patrician. Her background was safely hidden, and she misled people who asked her about it. But by now, Juliana was so dependent on this colorfully adorned myth of herself, so these invented origins were not so much social pretensions to her, but truths. Therefore, she was firm about them. Now here she is, the picture of glamour and worldliness photographed by Cecil B. And he said it took all day to get the photos right because Juliana had, quote, such a preposterous nose. The picture is a testament to Beebe's artifice, as you can see from Peggy Bacon's treatment of Juliana, done at about the same time. In Bacon's pastel, you can see why the artist's secret nickname for Mrs. Force was Mrs. Fierce. The official title of the pastel is Juliana Force, but on the sly, Bacon called it the Ugly Duchess. Juliana lived in Grand Lincoln. continues. By midnight, the artists in the place of a glorious shambles, sandwiches around the apartments, cigarette butts everywhere, even in the outstretched hands of some sculptures, and happily drunken artists passing out. Mrs. Force had two big strong men in livery standing by. And at a nod from her, these men began carrying drunks out of the 8th Street entrance and stacking them on the sidewalk. Show you the sculpture gallery, the outstretched hand, and the typical party at Juliana Force's apartment in the museum. Now, as the 30s wore on, the Whitney purchases became a lot less interesting for several reasons. First, the Whitney made it a policy to buy only items by biennial and annual exhibitions. This meant that purchases were restricted to one or two selections per artist instead of the entire contents of the studio, which is what she had done when she first started buying the museum. But when Juliana ignored this policy, she did very well. She was Rouge Player, for example, was bought from the downtown gallery, and in the case of Lachaise, Juliana decided that what Lachaise had submitted to the biennial shortly before his death was not quite what the museum needed. She arranged to substitute a cast of standing woman, a choice that nobody at the museum has ever regretted. Another primary reason why Whitney purchasing declined in adventurousness in the late 30s was the effect of one Frank L. Crocker, a Whitney family lawyer. Crocker had been responsible for making the museum into a tax-exempt public institution, which was blameless, but he viewed Juliana as a servant who had gotten out of hand, and the museum as a wasteful drain on Whitney capital. Need I say that he became a trustee of the museum? Crocker, who Juliana quickly learned to detest, had no aesthetic understanding and all he cared about was cost, so the acquisition's budget was slashed. The Whitney had promised to spend up to $20,000 a year on buying art, but after Crocker's ascendancy, the amount was cut drastically. In 1940, for example, the Whitney spent only $2,200 on acquisitions. Crocker also had various stupid suggestions for the museum, such as if Juliana wanted to buy something for every work of art she acquired for the Berman collection, she would have to sell something else that was already in it. Also, Juliana was hamstrung by Crocker, but not outwitted by him. But her position changed after the death of Gertrude Whitney on April 18, 1942. Now, as time went on, Flora Miller, Gertrude Whitney's daughter, became very proud of the museum and supported it vigorously. But in 1942, she was not much interested in art and was persuaded to Crocker's point of view. The museum cost too much, and Juliana was extravagant and irresponsible. So in the fall of 1942, without consulting Juliana or any of the rest of the staff, Crocker and Flora agreed to hand over the entire Whitney collection, plus the $2.5 million Gertrude left to the museum, to our old friend, the Metropolitan Museum of Art. Dr. Robinson was no longer there to turn it down, and Francis Henry Taylor, the curious director then, accepted the collection with relief. The Whitney would merge with the Metropolitan in 1943, and after the war was over, a wing would be built for the collection. The Whitney would be uptown, and the Whitney family would no longer be financially responsible. Juliana was devastated by this, and the artists were horrified. There were dozens of letters to her saying that the merger was all wrong. Everyone but the trustees recognized that the Whitney would be swallowed up by the move. The Whitney buildings on 8th Street were supposed to close down, but Juliana, who was suddenly got the Met to contribute some money for purchases, which is why these paintings went to the Met, and she got some funding from the Whitney. And this split arrangement went on for several years. The Met's money could only be spent on paintings, so the Whitney didn't buy too many oils for this. She used the money for sculpture and graphic books. And as I said, in 1943, this important Tom's Hart Benton, July Haying, and beautiful Tom one bear, beautiful floating Cupid's bow with the Met's money. So they went into the Met. With the Whitney's money, she bought those on paper. But most of the time, she couldn't get paintings. The prohibition of Paisley turned out to be a source of future fortune, as the Whitney, rather than the Met, ended up with some key pieces of sculpture, such as in 1946, she bought the Cockfight Variation by David Smith, and a year later, she bought Isamu Noguchi's Humpty Dumpty, one of his finest slave sculptures. And she could have seen them all in Noguchi's studio on the New York Alley, just out of that era. In the late 1940s, Juliana was not often well, and she chalked it up to indigestion. The sculptor Jane Lacey happened to model a bust of her in the autumn of 1947, and in contrast to this picture, taken just a few years before, you'll see that this stern, severe portrait recorded a face worn by pain. In October 1947, Juliana entered Columbia Presbyterian, and she stayed there for nearly 3 months. The diagnosis was an advanced stage of stomach cancer. She was operated on, but she was only given a few weeks to live. Juliana's response to this was not so much anguish, but fury. Her question was, how dare this happen to me? It was more an implication than a question, as if death were an unruly artist or an inept museum official. She was so angry about dying that she insisted she was going to live. Juliana made up her mind that she would treat cancer as she had every other. She was fighting it to get back down. To begin with, she submitted to any procedure that held out the door to cure, and she went through several excruciating operations. Meanwhile, things were not going well with the Metropolitan. Whitney's suggestions for acquisitions were rejected and considered grudgingly. In February 1948, Juliana resigned her position as art advisor. To resolve these tensions, Francis Taylor invited representatives of the Whitney and the Museum Modern Art for a friendly dinner. Alfred Barr and James Walso being represented the modern. Juliana was too sick to attend, so Goodrich and Herman Moore, another curator, went. Everything went pleasantly enough until dessert, but Taylor began attacking the Whitney, saying that the rest of the country hated abstract art and Whitney was showing too much of it. Barr and Sobey sided with Goodrich and Moore, and everyone argued back and forth across the table.